that. I am love, love, love. Love, love, love. Yes, live. I think this is the first time I've, you know, really used my voice this morning so far, so things are feeling a little bit, you know, it's fine. It's all good. It's all good. Whoa, got some weird stuff going on here. Let's get this going over here. Boop. Okay. Yeah, okay. Sorry. Had to get that thing going on there. Ooh, boy. I think I started a minute after 9 a.m. my time. It's been a while since I did a live office hours, since I did some live office hours. It's been a while. And maybe I'll put you down a little bit over here. Ooh, that's a little better. So now you can see my notes. Don't you see my notes? You might be able to, like, see that I actually use notes. What? It'll ruin the illusion. Will it ruin the illusion? Likely not. So yes, it's been a while since I did live office hours because I was on vacation, which you may be able to tell from my increased, you may be able to see my increased freckleage. You may be able to see more freckles. I don't know if you can see them. Yeah, a lot more freckles happening right now. Just, you know, that's what happens with my skin, with my weirdly melanated, yes, my weirdly melanated skin. My randomly melanated skin. Maybe that's a better way to put it. Randomly melanated. So, friends, as you know, as you likely know, oh, my name is Dr. Shannon Coates, and I am live here at Voice and the Art of Teaching. So, talking about voice pedagogy. Today we're talking about some, we're talking about child voice, some things about child voice, because on Wednesday, Wednesday morning, my time, muesli, oh, for my randomly melanated skin, yes, good morning, Eden, yes, I have some terrific, you know, sunblock things, but even with the sunblock, still, I still get a, you know, still get some freckles going. Good morning, Charm City Mezzo. Good morning. Oh, there's something in the corner of my screen that's shaking a bit. Oh, I bet. Does that fix it? It is probably, yeah, it's because I'm on two devices. I'm on both my, like, phone and my iPad. My phone is probably in the corner of my iPad a little bit, so. Because I'm, like, super techie over here. So techie. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, that was my phone in the corner of my iPad. So I'm on Instagram on my phone. Hey, Instagram friends. And I'm on Facebook on my iPad. Hey, Instagram friends. I'm such a tech genius. Okay, so on Wednesday, I am doing a pop-up voice ped class on child voice. And in that class, we are going to talk about the anatomy and physiology of the voice, and in fact, of the child voice, and how the development of breathing structures, of vocal tract structures, of laryngeal structures, how the development of those structures and the placement and the stability of those structures, how that affects tonal outcome, registration, range, all of our expectations around how tone and sound is created in the child voice. I'm also going to be talking about student-led learning. Yay, I know, children are singing so much more, right? Especially with the advent of our, it's a couple decades ago now, but especially since the advent of things like, you know, American Idol or America's Got Talent and Canadian Idol, British Idol, all of the idol shows, but those talent shows where we start to see children coming, being on stage, not in a choir and not in a musical and not in a chorus, but as soloists in their own right. And so we've had this sort of explosion in the independent voice studio of people wanting, children wanting voice lessons and parents wanting voice lessons, one-on-one voice lessons for their children. So this is a very popular, well-attended class that I do and that I have done in the past as well. And I've done a little bit of an update. To the class. So if you have taken the class before, there will be some review, but you are welcome to obviously take it again. But there will be some review, but also I've done some update in the content so that we're also talking about student-led learning, how to develop student-led learning, how to empower students and develop agency in students, even young voice students. So those kinds of things as well going to be in there. Let me just check here. Eden says, well, some of the kids have been doing Broadway Junior shows, etc., singing intensely for 1 to 2 weeks and performing, and then there are issues. Yes, and this is so lots and lots of folks who have taken this class with me before, lots of folks who do children's choirs, lots of folks working in, children's choirs especially. I would love to see more folks taking this very specific training and more folks who are working in like local theaters, more folks who are working with children in classroom situations. I'd love to see the folks who haven't necessarily had that really specific training about working with the child voice and who are working in situations, especially where there's like lots of intense singing going on. And I would love to see more folks like that taking this kind of training as well, for sure, for sure. So that's all coming up on Wednesday. And today, later on my socials today, I'm actually releasing an outline of what we're going to do in the class on Wednesday. And then the following week, for 2 weeks, I'm doing a child voice practicum with a Q&A with Nikki Loney, who, if you don't know her, then get over to the Full Voice, especially if you are working with children. Get over there and figure that out right now. Like, stop here, stop listening to me, and go look at the Full Voice right now. So Nikki Loney's coming into that practicum, and in the practicum, we're going to talk, we have live trainings twice a week, well, three times a week, but twice a week where it's live, where I'm saying, okay, try this, 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 and this, and here's why, do this, 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 and this, as well as then we also have 24/7 interaction through Marco Polo and on the Facebook group as well, where people are working out that training, where they're saying, okay, I've tried this and I wasn't sure, but, and how about this? And, you know, so that's all coming up, blah, blah, blah. Here's what I want to talk about today. because I'm talking about that, this week and next, August is sort of like Child Voice Month. And also, if you haven't seen it yet, I also did a child voice infographic, which I did it last year. I did it maybe even 2 years ago now. But it's a very popular infographic because the information in there just kind of like lays things out from the anatomy and physiology and then what to expect. So because of that anatomy and physiology. So today I wanted to talk about three myths around teaching children in one-on-one voice lessons. So three myths about having young singers in your voice studio, three myths. And I wanted to debunk these three myths. And the reason that I wanted to talk about these three myths is because I literally heard them very recently from, from folks who, these folks don't work with children on the regular, but they have an opinion apparently about it. So I heard these from some folks very recently talking, and these are folks who know their stuff. So they know voice ped, they know anatomy and physiology, they know voice science. These are folks who know their stuff, but they don't work with children. And so I heard these things so recently, and I just want to say, like, this stuff, these myths are still out there. They're still out there, and they're still being put forward by folks who have who are very knowledgeable in many other areas of teaching voice, but who still have, you know, who still think about these myths, or who still think these things are true about teaching children. And so I just want to, that's why I wanted to come on here and talk about that. So the first myth is that, and especially teaching young children, right? So a lot of the folks who no longer say that you have to wait until you're 13 or 16 in some cases to take voice lessons, you have to wait until you're 16, or you have to wait until you're 13 until your voice has changed, till you've gone through puberty, you have to wait. So a lot of the folks who no longer are like, oh, you have to wait till then to take voice lessons are now, well, 10 is the youngest that you should take voice lessons. Well, okay, but like, so I'm talking here, these are myths especially applied to 6 to 10 year olds, like teaching 6 to 10 year olds in one-on-one voice lessons. And don't get me wrong, I think there is a really great place to do group lessons with that age level. Like, don't get me wrong. I think, and again, go see Nikki Loney, go see her resources for group teaching, for teaching groups. I think group teaching at that level, at that age, is like fantastic, but you don't have to. And here are some of the myths around why you shouldn't. They're myths. Here we go. One of them that I heard very recently, it's super unhealthy. It's going to lead to bad habits in young children. When we're teaching voice lessons to one-on-one voice lessons to young children, it's going to lead to super bad habits where they're overpressurizing, where they're yelling, where we're teaching them to sound like adults, where we're doing all of these things that are going to make children have bad habits, because we're treating the children. And this is, so the myth that I heard was this, or the phrase that I heard, the phrase that was said was this: we have to be so careful because we're just going to harm and give them bad habits if we're teaching them like 6 years old, one-on-one. Okay, so that's the myth I heard. So here's the reasoning behind that. Here's the thing. So if you unpack that a little bit and ask people, okay, why do you think that? Here's what you'll generally hear. You'll generally hear, well, you're going to, when we try to teach them to sing, they're going to try to sound like adults, and they're going to try, and they're going to end up overpressurizing, they're going to end up yelling, they're going to end up with these bad habits for, you know, that's going to get them through puberty, and then they're going to be overpressurized singers, et cetera, et cetera. So we hear this kind of like, this understanding, this assumption around our teaching skills. So this, here's why this pisses me right off. This one makes me so angry, because what this assumes is that everyone who's teaching children from 6 to 10 years old doesn't know how to teach children from 6 to 10 years old. Like, or is just using the same things with children from 6 to 10 years old that they're using with teenagers or adults. That we're all trying to get our 6 to 10 year olds to like sound like adults. Or we're teaching our 6 to 10 year olds how to like sing O Mio Bambino Caro or something along those lines, right? Like, that's what the underlying assumption of that phrase is, that teachers are gonna do a bad job. The teachers are going to teach children to sound like adults and are going to impose the same things on children that we would ask for from teenagers and adults. Allison says, so needed to debunk. Love catching a child with pitch, rhythm, or technique issues. Not to mention basic breathing. Yes, exactly, right? Exactly. Exactly. So, sorry, I'm looking at some of the comments here on Facebook. So, I don't get this thought. Exactly. They're six. I'm going to teach them as a six-year-old. Of course you are, right, Sarah? Yes. So the underlying assumption with that, when someone says, oh, they're going to end up with bad habits, they're going to end up yelling, they're going to end up blah, 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 they're going to end up doing all of these things, the underlying assumption there is that teachers are all doing a bad job. Like, that's just bad teaching if they end up that way. That's just not good teaching. So that's annoying, because that can happen to any singer at any age, in any studio, with any teacher. Okay, so teaching a six-year-old requires a different kind of training. Of course it does. Do you think that people who teach six-year-olds don't know this? Oh my gosh. Okay. The second myth that I heard is that, like, everybody, and this kind of goes along with this underlying assumption as well. Like they're all gonna sound like Annie, and they're all gonna like we know what happens when they sing like Annie. They all get their voices hurt when they sing Annie. And yes, that's true. There have been issues with children who sing Annie. Yes, there have been, for sure. You know why? Because Annie was written a million years ago. There is like amazing. And when we try to, when we ask children to sing Annie the way it's written with like intensity and with no mics, yeah, we're probably going to get into some trouble. Probably, unless we've got like some specific things going on there. But overall, yeah, we're probably going to get into some trouble. Unmiked, the tessitura isn't actually awesome for children. It's not actually well written for children to sing. Annie isn't. Oops, sorry. It's true. It's not actually well written for children to sing. And when it was written, we weren't personal miking everybody. And yes, like of course we're gonna have some issues when we're working with that kind of when we're working with that rep. But it's like a million years old. There is so much repertoire now. So much repertoire. And people who teach 6 to 10 year olds, we know that there's a great rep out there now. We're very rarely, if ever, assigning Annie to our students to sing. Very rarely, if ever, right? It's not a great song. It's not, yeah, exactly, right, Tanisha? It's not well written. That role is not well written overall. I mean, there's some songs that are great, of course, but overall, when you sing that whole role, it's not great for kids. It's not well written for kids. But you know what? In this decade, in this day and age, there's tons of fabulous music written for the child voice to sing. Broadway, children's voice, children pop and rock. Like there's lots of amazing music out there that's written for children to sing so they can sound like children. And it's all mic'd now. So all of our pro shows and lots and lots and lots of our local shows, local theater shows, are mic'd. It's all mic'd. You know what that means? Yeah, and the parents, I know, parents, so parents have, yeah, that's a whole other thing too, isn't it, Wendy? I'll talk about that in a minute. But so we have this, like, there's this kind of like this, the myth that goes along with this is that, and oh, and the other one is that, like, or we're teaching them to sing O Mio Bambino Caro. So we're teaching them to sound like, some kind of adult opera singer. No, we're not. We're using age-appropriate repertoire, like, and by age, I don't necessarily mean, subject, although that's part of it, but we're using repertoire that is appropriately and written for the child voice to sing, and we're asking children to sound like children. We know how to do that. So we're asking children to sound like children in that repertoire. We're not asking them to sound like an adult when they sing repertoire. And sometimes, yeah, Wendy, that is a whole other thing too, when parents want their kids to sound like a certain way. So that's part of our this is something I'm going to talk about in the practicum actually, when we're working in the practicum. But that is something that is part of our job as educators, is to also educate parents about what is appropriate. What's an appropriate tonal outcome for children, and the fact that if they've heard an Annie sound, there are ways to sound like Annie for sure, and to have that belty sound, of course. But the least, one of the best ways to do that well, is to be mic'd. So we're not adding volume into the equation, right? So volume and needing to sound loud or needing to be heard in an auditorium or on stage or over an orchestra or whatever, that is something that adults can do because of the way that adult bodies are structured. That's something, and usually we do it in Western classical more than in other styles, but whatever. But that's something that adult bodies can do. It's not necessarily something that's great for kid bodies to do. It really isn't great for kid bodies to do. So that's something where we have the education with parents where we say, okay, I love that sound and we're going to make that sound, but it's going to be quiet. And then we're going to use the mic to amplify it. So we're going to make that intense sound. We're going to figure out how to do that intense sound, but it's actually going to be real quiet. Like you're not going to actually maybe even hear it from the first floor to the second floor of the house or whatever, right? From different rooms in the house. But once we put a mic on it, that's when it sounds like Annie, or it sounds like that you have the perception of it being loud, right? So anyway, that's a little bit of a side thing. But talking about educating parents is definitely something that we wanna, that we'll be talking about in the practicum. So repertoire for kids, kids blowing their voices out, singing Annie. Well, you know what? Annie's really old. Let's look at something else that might be a little bit better for written for child voice. Unhealthy bad habits. And then the third one that we hear all the time is that, okay, well, if they are going to take voice lessons, one-on-one voice lessons, then you shouldn't be teaching a real voice lesson. You should be teaching musicianship skills, not like a real voice lesson. So I get why people say this, right? I get why people say this because they're thinking to themselves, okay, I can't teach them the way that I would teach an adult or a teenager. I can't teach that same kind of like warm up with like, you know, we're learning how to mix or we're freeing the high notes or we're getting vibrato or whatever. Like I can't, or finding clarity or blah, blah, blah. I can't teach all of those things, all of those like technical things because the body isn't like ready for a lot of that stuff. So I'm just going to do musicianship skills. We're just going to do like rhythm and I'm just going to do rhythm and blah, blah, blah. So let me be clear. We want musicianship skills to be taught in voice lessons at all levels. Of course we do. Of course we want musicianship skills and musicianship skills of like, you know, training the ear, blah, blah, blah. We want all of those skills, of course. We want them to be in our lessons. However, just because I'm teaching a 6 to 10-year-old doesn't mean I'm not teaching the fundamentals of breathing. Doesn't mean I'm not teaching the fundamentals of crescendo, decrescendo. Doesn't mean I'm not teaching the fundamentals of all of the other, like phrasing. Doesn't mean I'm not teaching all of those fundamental skills and technical skills that I would be teaching with teenagers or adults. It's just that I'm doing them in a way that is appropriate to the age. Phone. I'm doing them in the way, let me see if I can just hang that up. Let's see. Yeah, kinda. Well, who knows? I'm doing them in a way that is appropriate to the age and stage of development of the child, right? So am I teaching like a Poggio full on inhalation, blah, 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 to a child voice? Oh, my gosh. This is the fun of working from home, and you're so welcome. You're so welcome. Just got a little reminder there from the doctor's office. Ah! Am I teaching full-on Apoggio, where I'm looking for an expansion lower in the body, and I'm looking for blah, blah, blah? No, I am not. But am I teaching breathing in a very fun, engaging way that is working for that child, where I'm not expecting to see, like, whoa, every time they inhale? Of course I am. Of course I am. Am I teaching them how to have coordination with the vocal folds and breath? So am I teaching them some onset work? Of course I am, in a very fun way. We're gonna work within the parameters of what the child voice can do, what's appropriate for the child voice in terms of where they are anatomically and physiologically, and what's appropriate for that child voice. And I'm gonna make it fun, and I'm not gonna be asking directly for things, but I'm gonna make it fun. And yes, we're still gonna get the fundamentals of technique in the child voice. Are we going to be working on articulation? Yeah, of course we are. You know, we're going to do tongue twisters. Super fun. We're going to work articulation. We're going to figure out what the tongue does when you say a T. We're going to figure out what the tongue does when you make an E vowel. We're going to figure out what the lips do when you make an OO vowel. Of course we are. We're going to do all of those things. Same things. Just going to be probably more fun. And using different tools. And with expectations that are grounded in what is actually physically possible in the child voice. Yeah. So, the three things, like I said, three things that drive me right up the wall and back down again. Woo, just right up the wall and back down again. Because of the underlying assumption in them, right? So the underlying assumption when someone says, oh, but when you teach children to sing, they're going to blow their voices out. Or, and we can do a little bit of what not to do. I prefer to stay away from, like, don't do this, of course, in my teaching. Prefer to stay away from that. But yeah, we can teach them what to do, right? Like, here are, we teach them what not to do by teaching them what to do, right? Jennifer says, preach, preach. So when someone says, oh, but they're going to get unhealthy habits and they're going to learn to pressurize and they're going to learn to do blah, blah, blah. That's because you think that I'm teaching them the same way that I teach teenagers and adults. Sarah, true. Yes, yes. Or Shara, sorry. Yes, the challenge can be to find creativity, right? To find those creative ways to implement these foundational things, for sure. That can be part of the challenge. Again, big old shout out for the full voice if you... If you're not already on that bandwagon, get on that bandwagon. There's also a group on Facebook called Voice Teachers of Young Children. I think that's what it's called. Voice Teachers of Young Singers, Voice Teachers, something along those lines. I'll link it on Facebook and on Instagram. You're gonna have to go over to Facebook and find it. and then the full voice, obviously. The other one that folks say is like, oh, well, they're going to be singing Annie, they're going to blow their voices out, because they have no idea that there's great repertoire for kids out there. Right? Oh, is it young singers? Thank you, Allison. Yeah. And the other one is that you can only teach musicianship skills. You can't teach actual, you know, technical skills. Not true. So, and like I said, all of those things come out of, I hear those things out of the mouths of folks who don't work with children pretty regularly, right? So like, that's like, it's pretty clear that you don't work with children when you think that. Or if you do work with children and you still have these thoughts in your mind, just haven't figured it out yet, right? Just haven't figured it out yet. Oh, wait, I've got this, like, there is this great repertoire out there. I can use this repertoire. So, yes, that's where I'm going to leave it today. I'm going to leave it leave it on that note. And maybe someday I'll edit out the phone call. Maybe not. Maybe I'll just leave it forever. Just like a, you know, like a, what are those called? Not a typo, but you know, like comedy reel? No. Can't remember what they're called. You know, when you do something and it's not like what you intended, but it's kind of funny. Blooper! Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you. A blooper. I should make a blooper reel. That could go on, the blooper reel. Me trying to figure out what a blooper is. Could be on the blooper reel. Okay. Friends, have a terrific week. If you are not on my mailing list, you might want to get on there. You can also, if you're on the mailing list, you will get a code to get 10% savings on my VoicePed pop-up classes. Again, one of which is on child voice and is this coming Wednesday. All right. Take good care. I will see you on the socials. Happy teaching. And...